Hello world, and we're back. And this is gonna be episode...
Boy, that escalated quickly. I mean, that really got out of hand fast.
My name is Kyle Fischl. Previously, we have been in a pretty bad downswing. And downswings are the absolute worst in poker. It's like...
Imagine the most horrible, terrifying, evil thing you can possibly think of. And multiply it by six!
But the only way to really get out of them is to just kind of stay positive, keep going there, know it's just variance, know it's going to come back, and just, and you know, go in there and just do your best.
Your best. Losers always whine about their best. Winners go home and f*** the prom queen.
You're right, Sean Connery. Let's just go in there and crush souls. Alright, so the last session I played was Friday, June 7th, and it went pretty good. The first interesting hand that happened was I'm under the gun plus one, pocket kings, pretty standard raise, make it $30. I get three callers, so we're four ways to a flop, which comes 8-4-4, all offsuit. Now, out of position, 8-4-4, pretty slam dunk value bet. No one should really have a four, like, they just shouldn't, and if they do, hope a king comes, I guess. I bet $80. There's a lot of sticky players at these 2-5 games, especially on Friday nights. So there's all kinds of overcards that I'll call, ace highs that I'll call. And I'm pretty happy charging a strong price for them to continue. Otherwise, I'm happy to just take the pot down. Well, I do get one caller. And the turn is an offsuit 5, full rainbow on board. And first act again, I see no reason to slow down. I bet $150. I mean, 6-7 gets there, but I'm not worried about that. Like, there shouldn't be a 4. I can get a lot of ace-8s to call twice. I can get any pocket pair, 9s to queens calling. Shouldn't really have aces, should re-raise that pre-flop. So, I'm confident that I have the best hand and hope he continues, which he does. He calls. Now, the river is another 8. So, now kings are a pretty scary board there. However, first to act, I really don't want to check and give him a chance to blow me off my hand. Because if I check and he bets like $300, $400, I might have to fold. I might have to call. But we're either way, we're going to try to eliminate that difficult decision. And we're just going to lead out for $250. And we get snap called.
Congratulations, you played yourself.
That's not good. And it wasn't the snap call like one chip throw and give the pot to me. It wasn't the snap call where it's verbal and you just know that it's bad. It was a snap call where he grabbed exactly $125 worth of green chips and flung them in there. Very odd snap call. I don't know if that's confidence or something else. But luckily for us, he has pocket jacks. We start off with a pretty strong win.
Wow! I feel good. I knew that I wouldn't. I feel good.
The next interesting hand that happens, under the gun raises to 30. There's two callers. I'm on the button. I have ace jack of spades. A good 3-bet candidate. But I'm not that deep at this point. I'm going to get called by all the ace kings, ace queens, every hand that's beating me anyway. So we'll just call, hope to get some spades, see what happens. Well, the flop comes ace, jack, 10 with 2 clubs, 1 spade. Now that's a pretty good flop for me, and it's even better when the under the gun player leads out. The under the gun player bets 40, the two middle players fold. And now it's on to me. Now, because it's such a draw-heavy board, you probably should raise here. But I decided to take it a little bit slower because, you know, I've been running pretty bad. I don't want to raise and get an absolute, you know, nuke of a card hit and me just have bloated the pot. So we'll do a little pot control and we'll just call here. Well, the turn is about as brick as it can get. It's a 6 of hearts. Now, when Dawn of the Gun player bets 50, that's pretty small, especially in relation to the size of the pot. Now, he could be trapping with a hand like King-Queen, which is full-on nuts. Or, you know, he could actually not have that great of a hand and just be nervous about it. He could have a naked king or queen. He could have queen-jack, king-jack, king-ten, queen-ten, all of those. I think it's too small to have ace-king, ace-queen. I think you bet a little more there. You're a little happier with it with top pair. But I think there's a lot of weak hands that play this way. So now it's time to raise, because any club, any king or queen hits the river, and I have a much worse, much more difficult decision. So I raise to 180, and he thinks about it for a bit and then calls. The river is a seven of hearts, another complete brick, very happy with it. He checks to me. I'm happy with the size of the pot. I don't really see any worse hand calling me here. So I just check it down, and he has queen nine offsuit. So he would not have called a bet anyway, and we're happy that we did not get drawn on this time. On this next hand, it is the same dynamic. The under the gun player in a button straddled pot makes it 45. A short stack in the middle call, and I'm sitting on the button with ace queen offsuit. I decide to just call. Could three bet again, but we were able to get some good value from him and outplay him when we connect with the board. So we're gonna just see what happens. The flop is ace deuce five, all offsuit. And this time the under the gun player checks. Now the middle position, who's short stacked, he shoves all in for about 140 some dollars. Me, I don't see any reason to raise because ace king's gonna call. I don't think ace jack's gonna call. I don't think any worse ace is gonna call. And, you know, ace five has me beat. So I just call, fully expect to just be heads up with this guy and have the best hand. Well, no, sir.
I'm afraid that was a wrong answer.
The under the gun player calls again, and I'm not too happy with that. We're just gonna see how the hand develops. The turn brings a six of, it puts two hearts, but we're not too worried about it, especially when he checks to me. Like, he shouldn't really have too many 5-6, 6-4. Six really shouldn't help him at all. So we bet 160 into a side pot because now we're hoping he has like some kind of ace, some kind of pocket pair that doesn't believe me. And even if he has some kind of a straight draw, we might be able to get it to fold because we've been running pretty bad. But he calls 160, and I'm really not sure where I'm at this point. When the river brings a four, I'm not happy with it because three makes a straight. You know, he's got a four-liner on board. It's really not a good card. 7-8 got there, but he really shouldn't have that either. But he checks to me, very happy to just check it down, and he says pair of fours. What do you mean pair of fours? You mean pocket fours? You mean 4-5? You mean ace four? And he just shows 1-4. What four did you call with? That's not two pair. King four? I don't know. Either way, we will be happy with that extra $160 you called to turn with.
If you like pina coladas and getting caught in the rain.
A bit later in the night, against a very strong reg, he opens it up from early to $30. I'm in late position. I have ace king offsuit, so definitely gonna put in the three bet this time, make it $80, and the pre-flop raiser is the only caller. The flop comes ace queen four. Ace and queen are both hearts, fours of clubs. This player leads out for $75. At this point, I have a decision to make. He only has about 400 behind, and I genuinely consider just putting him all in. My argument against that is I think ace-queen is a very high probability for the hand he has. I think it's a good early position bet to 30, call the 3 bet. Wow, I made two pair. Hope he has ace-king. So, because of that, and I know ace-queen's just going to snap off, ace-jack, ace-10, probably fold. And hearts may call, may fold. Kind of 50-50 on if hearts would stay. Either way, we're just going to call, see what happens. And the turn is a king of diamonds. How did that card get there? Does the poker gods not know how I've been running? I don't deserve to actually get there once.
You got them!
Either way, the opponent now checks to me. And when he checks, I can definitely assume he does not have Jack 10, which is pretty much the only hand that beats me. I'm actually very confident this player has Ace Queen. So I need to pick a sizing that not only would get a call no matter what, but possibly even get him to make a mistake and shove all in on me. So I bet the same size that he did. I do 75 out there because I honestly think that now with his stack of about under 300, it's the right size where it looks weak and he might raise all in with ace queen. He might think that ace king could fold and he could rep jack 10, but he really can't. He might think he could rep kings and get me to fold, but he can't. But either way, I think that I set him up good for a price to just jam bluff. But no, he just calls. When the river is an offsuit 7, he leads out for $30. Now to me, this looks, again, extremely blockerish. It looks like ace queen, it feels like ace queen. Now I can't just raise to 75, that's kind of weird. Kind of want to get all the money in. He's only got a little under 250-ish now. So shove all in. I'm thinking he may tilt call. Otherwise, you know, we raise when we think we have the best hand. He thinks about it for about 30, 45 seconds. He literally knows I have ace king. He shows ace queen and then throws it in there. And being a good sport, showing a good fold, I'll show that you did a good fold and I'll show that I had the winner. But good hand, sir. Okay, so the last two hands I'm going to go over, they have kind of an interesting dynamic. The person to my direct right is a very young, Asian poker player. Now, he's clearly very well educated in the game. He is, clearly knows what he's doing. Probably one of the best players at the table at the time. Now, he's been the only one who's been 3-betting besides me. One hand against him, I had ace-queen. He raised to 30. I made it 75. He made it 250. I fold ace-queen. Only 4-bet I've seen in the game all night. So he's willing to battle. He's willing to throw the money around. He's not scared to do $300 bets with air and get called and lose to fourth pair. I've seen that as well. In the first hand of battling against him, I have ace 9 of spades in the small blind. He's on the literal button. He's on my direct right. He makes it 30. Not going to fold a suited ace, especially to this player. And the big blind comes along as well. So three ways to the flop. It comes 6-7 deuce, all off suit. Now I check, big blind checks. The button bets 25. Now me, looking at this board, looking at my hand, knowing the opponent, I have a backdoor straight draw, backdoor flush draw, I have a pair draw. I have like the nuts here. So I'm gonna put in the raise, especially because I have a very strong range advantage. I could easily have 6-7, I could easily have any 7, I could easily have 8-9, a little bit looser for the 8-9, but there are a lot of hands that I have that should be much better than his. So I raised to 75, big blind folds, and he puts in the call. The turn is an 8. Decent card, not the best one. 8 of spades would have been a better card, but we are not unhappy with that card. So because we're in the small blind first to act, we're just going to continue the story. We have a strong hand. We bet $150, and he quickly folds. And of course, I have to show it because
it's not about money. It's about sending a message.
So the hand I'm going to talk about next is against the same player, and it happened after this hand, which I think may have played a part in it. You tell me, viewers, with a comment. So an early position player makes it $30. There's two callers. He is one of the callers, and I'm sitting in late position with ace-king off suit. Definitely going to put in the 3-bet again. I make it $150. Hoping to just get some folds and get $120 free. That does not happen. Only the player to my direct right calls. The flop is 9-6-3, all off suit. And I'm very happy with that flop. He checks to me. I don't really see a reason to bet here because, again, I think nines would call. I think any pair would call. And because I'm fully expecting him to spaz out at some point, put in a $200-$300 bet with air, I don't want to bloat the pot to where that bomb comes in at like $700-$800. And even though I'm certain he's bluffing, I'm still going to fold. So I do a little bit of pot control here. The turn is actually a 9. Now, when that 9 comes, I'm actually very happy with it. He checks to me. I am super confident that he does not have a 9. Like, there's just no way he has a 9. And if he has any pair, 10s to kings, he would have bet by now. I'm almost dead certain that he's got fully air. Just two random cards between 10 and ace. I bet $150. It's kind of a down bet. It's kind of small. But I'm actually value betting with ace high right now. I'm actually betting this, wanting a call, wanting any card lower than a 9 to hit so I can call his bet of whatever he's going to fire on the river. I'm very confident that's how this hand's going to go. And any card under a 9, I'm going to call whatever he spews off. Any card between 10 and queen, I'm definitely going to have to do some thinking about it. But, and a king or an ace, I'm going to be, you know, pretty much happy with the winner. Well, the river's an ace. That's definitely probably the best card I could think of. A king could arguably be better, but we will definitely take the ace all day. Now, this player counts out a bet of 340. Then he adds another 50. Then he adds another 50. Then he adds another 50. Just slowly, like every 10 to 15 seconds, he adds a little bit more to it. And then he puts out a bet of $500. Now this, honestly, I think is a live tell. And yes, I know the people out there watching this are going to be like, oh, he thinks this is a tell. I'm going to use this on him later. But, whatever. This is usually a live tell. If you count out your bet and then you raise it, like slowly, it's usually a bluff. Because people don't really value bet saying, I can get $350 from him. No, I think I can get $400 from him. No, I think I can get $450 from him. It's more the mentality of, oh, I have nothing. I hope he folds. I really hope he folds. Jesus, I need him to fold. Well, if I do this much, he has to fold. That's normally what it means. I'm fairly certain he has air. And I'm really happy with this $500 bet. Thank you for my new Oculus VR headset. I consider raising because I may also need a gaming computer, but my argument for just calling is every 9 is going to call anyway. Even if you had ace-jack, I'm pretty certain you're going to fold to a raise the size I would need to do it, and I'm certain that you just have air, so there's just no reason to do it. So I just call, and he insta-mucks. I've never seen a snap muck before, but he does. Thank you for my new gaming headset, and we rack up a huge win. So, thank you all for the nice comments, especially in the last two videos when I've been getting kicked around like crazy. I really like hearing lines about how people would play hands in certain situations. It helps me out. I think other people read the comments themselves, and there are some discussions that happen on my videos, which I'm happy about. If there's a hand you think I played well, played poor, could have done better, please let me know. Thank you for watching, and feel free to subscribe for more interesting and funny vlogs. Thank you. That you like Pina Colada.